Hi students, welcome to Structural Engineering Lectures and welcome to the new playlist on the Design of Shell Structures conforming to IS 800-2007 Limit State Method. In today's class, we shall see the design of roof trusses, that too, design of the roof trusses with angles, like I said, angular roof trusses, either with a single angle or double angle as appropriate. And we'll try to find out the dead loads, live loads and wind load calculations on the given roof truss that we'll be considering a fin truss, and we'll try to analyze using the method of joints and method of section, and if time permits, we'll design the members also, right? In the previous class, you have seen the types and components of roof trusses and what are the dead load, live load, wind load calculations as per the different code and specifications. I hope you enjoyed the discussions there. Then don't forget to click like, share, subscribe to our YouTube channel. Now, before we see the actual discussion, let us see the brief profile of the speaker, that is Dr. D. Rupesh Kumar. Obtained my BTech Civil Engineering from Nagarjuna University in 1994, MTech Structural Engineering from JNTU Hyderabad in 2000, and PhD Structural Engineering from JNTU Hyderabad in 2009. Presently, I am working as Professor of Department of Civil Engineering, University College of Engineering, Osman University, Hyderabad, Telangana State. I have an experience of 27 years, of which 7 years is in industry and 20 years is in teaching and research at graduate and postgraduate levels. My research areas include reinforced cement concrete design, steel structural design, structural analysis, point element analysis, earthquake engineering, bridge engineering, structural optimization. I have published 45 research papers in international as well as national journals and conferences, and organized 3 national conferences and 11 national conferences and workshops, and attended 43 workshops, visited 2 countries, delivered 13 guest lectures, and edited 3 books. Supervising 14 PhD scholars and supervising 30 ME theses. I am actively involved in various consultancy works that are offered by the department and completed over 770 design proof checks and 150 designs of the RCC, steel, composite, low-rise, high-rise, multi-short buildings and road as well as rail bridges. Right? So once we see this, let us move quickly to the term. Discussion student, right? But for, before we see the actual discussion, let us see what we'll be discussing, right? This is how the finger truss will be given, right? This is a finger truss, student, right? Which I want to analyze, right? This finger truss, right? After we'll fix the geometry, keeping in with the data given. We'll try to fix the geometry and we'll try to assess the loads, dead load, live load, wind load, on the given on the joints, and we'll try to analyze that using method of joints as well as the method of section in today's class, right? This is what in brief what we'll be discussing, student. Now let us also see the different schematics, right? This is just now shown that this is a finger truss or French truss. It's a geometry. Now we'll try to fix that in the problem, right? Wherein these are the different components, and this is a top chord member, and this is a rafter, right? And this is the bottom chord member, and for the top chord member, we do have the purlins over which the roof sheeting is attached, right? By means of the cleat angles, right? And even we would have this ridge point, right? And this is what called the main sling, and these are called the minor slings, right? Minor slings, as well as these are the struts. And this is the bottom chord member or the tie, and this is the support system, right? Then, however, once I see this, let us also see the other schematic, right? Once I see this, right, this you already seen, right? The other day is a 3D schematic, 3D schematic representing the roof trusses. However, here I am showing this using a rigid frame. The same is also applicable using this truss also. Right, truss also, right? Now, and I'll try to analyze and get the dead load and live load, which are the gravity loads acting in the downward direction, as well as the wind load. The wind load, like this, right? Yes, right. This is the dead load and live load. What I'm trying to get, and the wind load. The wind load, right? Now, and also, if I see. Roof truss, right? This is what a real photograph of a roof truss. Therefore, this is a top part member, bottom part member. We are trying to analyze them, even as well as we are trying to design them. And we can see these are purlins over which the roof sheeting is attached. Roof sheeting is attached. These are called the panel points, right? This is a panel point, right? And the entire truss, this is a span, the span which is supported onto the stanchions are push columns, right? Now even this also another schematic where this is now just remove that sheeting, roof sheeting is not put here. Even now we can see the purlins as well as the top quad member, bottom quad member, and the other members, right? Other members, right? Wherein even this also another schematic wherein here even we can see the girds, right? Wall girds, right? Even the side wall girds as well as that of the end parallel girds also, to which the roof sheeting will be attached, right? And the same after erection of these side walls as well as that of the brickwork, right? Even we do have the openings in the form of the windows here, student, right? Even at the top, roof sheeting is also there, right? Even there is an opening in the form of the door, opening in the form of the roof. This is what the finished roof truss building, which is generally used for assembly purpose or that of the workshop building as appropriate, right? As appropriate. Now let us see a numeric problem from a problem student. Now let us move to that numeric problem wherein this is how the problem is analyze and design a finger truss for an industrial building, for the following data. This is for industrial building student. Please make a note, right? The overall length of the building L capital L is equal to 48 meters and the overall width of the building is equal to 16.5 meters capital B, and width or the center to center column distance is equal to 16 meters, or this is also called referred to as the span of the truss, just now shown, right? And the rise of the truss is equal to 1/4 of the span, and the self weight of the purlins is equal to 318 newton per meter, and center to center distance of this spacing of these stresses is equal to 8 meters, and the height of the columns up to the eaves level is equal to 11 meters, and roofing is made up of the asbestos cement sheets, and its intensity of the load is given as 171 newton per meter square, right? And building is located in an industrial area of Allahabad, right, in India, and both ends of the truss are hinged, right? Use Fe410 grade steel. Fe410 grade steel. Generally, now we'll be using these angular sections, right? Either single angular, double angular as appropriate. Therefore, there's an angular truss. This is an angular truss, not the tubular truss. This is not a tubular truss, right? Now, even we do have a tubular truss design, which is discussed in advanced shield design playlist. You may just revisit it if you are further interested, right? Analysis and design of a tubular truss, right? In ASD, advanced shield design, right? Tubular structure designs, right? You may just revisit it, right? Now, let us see. For this given data, now first what I need to do is I need to fix the truss geometry, right? Now what is given is the rise is given as 1/4 of the span, right? This is what rise, student, right? This is what called the rise, right? Therefore, this is the span is already given. The clear span is given as 16 meter, whereas the effective span is given as 16.5 meter, right? Therefore, the rise is 1/4 of 16 meter is equal to 4 meters. Therefore, this is how that rise is 4 meter. This rise is equal to 4 meter from the bottom quad member or the main tie, right? This is called the main tie, student, right? This is how from the bottom quad member, right? Now, once I examine this, now let us also see this bottom quad member, right? Not this, right? Just wait. Yes, right? This is up, right? This is the rise, just now we have seen 4 meters, right? Once I see this rise, let me go to the other calculation set, and also this half of the span is equal to 8 meters, student, right? Therefore, now what I'll do is that, right, from this figure or schematic, I can say that tan theta is nothing but this opposite side, 4 meter by 8 meter by 8 meter. Therefore, it now works out, therefore, theta is equal to tan inverse, right? Therefore, this angle theta between the top quad member, this top quad member or rafter and the bottom quad member or principal tie is equal to 26 degree 57 minutes is now obtained, right? And also the This length of the rafters or the that of the top chord, this top chord member is equal to, right? Therefore, this is the square root of 4 square plus 8 square. It now works out, say, 8.94 meters. 8.94 meters. However, here fink truss requires a minimum of 4 panels, right? Then only a fink truss can be geometry can be defined. Therefore, I require at least these 4 panels. Therefore, the length of such each panel is equal to 8.94 divided by 4. It now works out, say, 2.236 meters. Therefore, this is 2.236. There are such 4 panels. However, from figure now I can also say that cos theta is nothing but the adjacent side is 2.236 meter divided by the hypotenuse. Now hypotenuse is equal to how much? Therefore, that hypotenuse will now work out, say, from this only unknown is equal to hypotenuse is 2.5 meter. Therefore, that is how I'm just getting from this expression, 2.5 meter, right? Therefore, this is just a 2.5 meter. Even similarly, this is 2.5 meter. At the other end side, I have 2.5 meter. Therefore, 10 meter is, if I deducted 10 meters from 16 meters, now I'll get 6 meter. Therefore, that divided by 2 because of the symmetry of this. Now I can say these are 3 and 3 meters. That is how the length of the bottom chord here between these parallel points L2 and L3 is equal to 6 meters. That is how I have just fixed the different lengths of the continuous bottom chord member or principal tank, right? Even now, let me also see the different lengths of the members. Once I fix the geometry, even I can find out the lengths using from simple trigonometry student. Therefore, I have from this figure tan theta is equal to, right, L1 U1 tan theta is equal to opposite side by this adjacent side, whereas adjacent side is equal to 2.235. Therefore, L1 U1 is equal to 2.235 tan theta. Theta is equal to this 26 degree 57 minutes. Now it works out, say, 1.12 meters is this length of this chord. Similarly, this is for 2.235. Therefore, over two such lengths, two multiplied by 2.235, this length of that chord will now work out this double that value. Therefore, 1.12 multiplied by 2 is equal to 2.24. Similarly, if you simply proceed because of the symmetry also, I can say, right, this is 1.12 meter. That is of the length of the struts are obtained. These are called the struts, student, right? These lengths are 1.12 and 2.24 and 1.12 respectively, right? Now, let us see that of the, what are the lengths of these minor slings and major slings, right? If I take I'll now find out what is this length, right? Therefore, this now works out, say, from this triangle, from this triangle now I can obtain what is it length L1 U2 can also be obtained. It is now working out square root of 2.231 whole square plus 1.12 whole square, or say 2.5 meters, student, right? This is how just calculated this length also, right? This length also, L1 U2. Therefore, even now let us move to that of the length of this. This is a minor slings, student, right? These are the minor slings. Each of these are 2.5 meter. And now let us find out what is the length of this major sling, right? Therefore, now I already have this, right? 3 meter is known, and even that height is equal to. This is 4 meter, right? Therefore, now I'll find out what is this inclined length, square root of 3 square plus 4 square. However, now if I just divide that into 2 panels, now we'll get the length of each of these panel length as a L2 M1 and M1 U4. Now L2 M1 is obtained as a 2. L2 M1 is obtained as 2.48 meter. Therefore, that is how L2 M1, this is 2.48. That is how I obtained the different lengths of the members of half of the symmetry. Remaining half of the symmetry is same, right? Now I hope you understood how we fixed the geometry as well as how we obtained the lengths of each of these members. Length of each of these members, right? Now once I fix the geometry, now let me go to the next step as the load calculations is the next subheading, right? Therefore, I want to find out the loads on the panels, right? Therefore, now first I'll find out within that the dead load, second one is live load, as well as the third one is wind load. Therefore, now let us see first the dead loads, right? Now, assuming the self weight of the bracings, even we would have the bracings even on the top part member as well as the bottom part member, even on the sides also, right? Therefore, the other day I explained this elaborately in the previous video, just to go through this, right? Therefore, that weight of these bracings as a 12 newton per meter square, now I have to have the even the self weight of the asbestos sheets is already given in the problem as say data 171 newton per meter square, 171 newton per meter square. If it is not given, then you can revisit it to this IS 875 part 1 student, right? Even it gives what are the different unit weights of these roofing systems, be it be asbestos or that of the alaba tiles, etc., etc. Therefore, from even IAJ 75 part 1, you can note down that one, right? And also, the self weight of the roof truss given by this empirical formula, that span by 3, whereas span is a clear span 60 meter by 3 plus 5 multiplied by 10, so that now I'll get 103.3 newton per meter square, or approximately say 110 newton per meter square, right? Per unit area, this is the weight of the truss, self weight of the truss. Please make a note, right? The consisting of these angles, right? Single angle, double angle, right? Is 110. And also the self weight of the purlin is also given. Self weight of the purlin is also given, right? Now, let me also calculate what are the self weight of these purlins, right? Now, just before I calculate these self weight, student, let me show the schematic like this, right? The schematic, right? Just now fix it, this truss, the truss geometry is like this, student, right? This is what just now fix it, the truss, right? Truss. This is what the geometry I've just fixed, right? Half the symmetry I'm showing, right? Wherein this is the top part member, which will be consisting of the two angles back to back to either side of a gusset plate, right? Either side of a gusset plate, and this is called the rafter, even. Right, or that of the top chord member, which is a principal compression member, even there's the bottom chord member is also consisting of, generally we will assume that it will be consisting of two angles back to back, or this is called the principal tie at the bottom, right? Principal tie, and these are the struts. Generally the struts are made up of the single angle connected to one side of a gusset plate, like this, right? This strut, as well as that of the minor slings are also assumed by means of the single angle connected to one side of a gusset plate, whereas this is the main sling. Main sling will also be a part and parcel of the truss load transfer mechanism. Therefore, this will also be made up of the two angles back to back, like this, right? Therefore, this is of the two angles back to back, right? That is how the geometry is fixed. And assuming these angle sections, like this, right? Either one single angle or double angle as appropriate. Now, I'll the self weight of this truss, given by this empirical formula, just now calculated, it worked out 110 newton per meter square, right? And self weight of the purlins also, right? 318 newton per meter. Therefore, using this, now I'll find out, right? This is the plan, therefore, I would have the 16.5 meter as the effective span of this center of the columns, right, which is 16.5 meter. Even what is given is the length of the building is equal to 48 meters, and what is also given is that the columns means the bay center of the columns in length direction is 8 meter. This is called the end bay, right? This is the end bay, and this is the end bay, whereas these are called the intermediate bays, right? Each are spaced at 8 meter. Therefore, I do have the 6 bays, right? 8, 6 are 48, right? That is a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, right? 6 bays. There are 2 end bays, whereas 4 intermediate bays, right? Wherein, if I want to analyze, generally I'll take an intermediate bay on which the loading is from this 8 by 2, right? Even on the other side, 8 by 2. Therefore, that once again load is attracted from 8 meters, right? Now, that is how. Now let me calculate the self weight of the purlin. Therefore, the self weight of the purlin, just now told that These are the pilots related. Let me see this figure. Not this one. Yes. These are the pilots. These are the pilots. What I am trying to do. Or let me show. Let me show using this photograph, right? These are the pilots, right? Or a real photograph, right? This one. These are the pilots, right? These are the pilots. What I am trying to do. Or this is that parlane. This is that parlane. Therefore, here this is 8 by 2, 8 by 2. Therefore, the load on this parlane is equal to from 8 meter. Right? These spacings of the columns are at 8 meter, 8 meter. Then that is just now fixed. Therefore, the load is from 8 by 2, 8 by 2, 8 meter. Right? Hence, now I will calculate the slip rate of these parlanes is equal to 318 multiplied by 8, which is equal to say 2544 newtons. Similarly, the panel length in plan, right? If I see this at 2.235, right? Let me go to this figure related. This 2.235 cos theta. Therefore, this when I drop a vertical, right? When I drop a vertical, right? Therefore, in plan, it is just 2.235 cos theta or cos 26 degree 57 minutes. Therefore, this will work out just 2 meters only, right? Therefore, this panel in plan is only just 2 meters. Just 2 meters, please make it, right? And the load on the intermediate panel that I already told that I am analyzing this intermediate truss, right? Similarly, I am analyzing an intermediate panel first to start with. Later on, I will also analyze the, I will obtain the load on the end panel also, right? For that now works out, say, this 12 self-rate of the bracing 12 plus this self-rate of the asbestos sheet 171 plus the self-rate of the truss at a rate of 110 newton per meter square. All these are terms of for plan area, that multiple by plan area, right? Plus due to that of the parlance is equal to 2544 newton. Therefore, this summation now works out, say 293 multiplied by the plan area is this 8 meter by this 2 meter, right? 2 meter, right? This is a 8 by 2, whereas this is just only 2 meter. Please make a note. Therefore, 60 meter is the plan area, right? That plus this 2544, it now works out, say around 7232 newtons, or say approximately 7.4 kilonewton is the dead load. Therefore, there is a at intermediate panel here I'm getting 7.4, whereas on the end panel load on the end panel is equal to half of that. Therefore, that works out say 3.7 meter. Even this is the end panel student, right? This is how 3.7, whereas even there will be another end panel on the other side. Therefore, that even both actually this is a that original this one student, that is a 3.7 and 3.7, both will now work out say once again 7.4 here, 7.4. therefore, that now works out say 7.4, right? Like that, even these are the 7.4s, whereas that of the end panels are only that 3.7 meter. These are the different loads, dead loads in terms of the kilonewtons acting in the gravity direction, right? Now next one. Next one is that of the live loads, right? Here, the slope of this roof truss is 26 degree 57 minutes, which is greater than 10 degrees. Therefore, once it is greater than 10 degrees, then what I need to do is that for this, I need to refer back to IS 875 part 2 student, right? Therefore, I would have these imposed loads if the slope up to and including 10 degrees, right? 10 degrees 1.5, whereas if it is more than 10 degrees, this 2, right? Sloping roof with greater than 10 degrees, then for roof membrane sheets or purlins, points, this live load, imposed load or live load intensity from IS 875 part 2 1987, page number 14. This is given as 0.75 minus 0.02 kilonewton per meter square for every increase in slope more than 10 degrees, but not less than 0.4 kilonewton per meter square. Therefore, once I know this, let me just substitute into this substitute into this, so that now we'll get right. Therefore, the intensity of the load is equal to WL 750 minus 20 for every increase more than 10 degree. I will have more than 10 degree is 16 degree 57 minutes. That multiplied by 20. If I deduct from 750, now I'll get say approximately 490 newton per meter square. Right? Hence, the total live load on each individual panel is equal to this intensity multiplied by plan area. Plan area is equal to 2 multiplied by 8. It now also say around 6698 newtons, or it is approximately 6.7 kilonewton. However, the load on the end panels is equal to that divided by 2. 6.7 divided by 2 means 3.35. Therefore, this is on the end panels 3.35, whereas on all the intermediate panels it is equal to 6.7 due to live loads like this, right? Therefore, now this is how just now I got these right dead loads and live loads, right? Just now I explained. Now I need to get these wind loads also, right? Now I need to analyze for the wind load. Just now I have analyzed this for dead load and live load, right? Now let me move to the third load, is the wind load. Therefore, there is the third subheading, wind loads, as per this IEC 875 part 3. However, now assuming the life span of this industrial building as 50 years, or the 50 years return period, and the land is plain, and it is surrounded by the small building. These are my assumptions, student. Therefore, if I go to this IEC 875 part 3, 2015 new code, table 1, page number 7, right? Let me move to that new code, 2015, right? Yes, and from this table, all general buildings, 50 years return period, right? Whereas this is located in Allahabad, right? This building is located in Allahabad, where what is the intensity of the wind in the Allahabad, that I need to note down, right? That can be for this Allahabad, you please see that from, let me just see this first, right? Therefore, from figure 1 of page 6 of this new code, or that of the old code 1987 875 part 3, from figure 1 page number 9, this Allahabad is having a basic wind speed of 47 meter per second. Let me just revisit that, right? Let me revisit this new code, student, right? I'll come to this. I'm just revisiting this figure wherein the entire India is divided into contour maps wherein I do have, right? These are the contours. Right, these are the contours, right, where the Allahabad, right, if I see the Allahabad is this is a map of the India showing the basic wind speed, right? Therefore, this Allahabad is located in this contour, wherein, and I'll just note down what is that contour, right? It is there in this 47 meter per second. I just now noted that one, right? Or even you can note down that same from the IS 875 part 3 old code 1987 also, either of the two is true, right? Once I note down that, now what I do is I note down the risk coefficient from this page number 7. Let me go to this page number 7 of the new code, right? Page number 7, yes. There I do have the for 47 meters, student, right? Yes, right. For 47 meters, K1. Or before I see what is this K1, let me see the formula, student, right? Whereas this was basic coefficient, this basic wind speed is given as per the new code. I need to obtain the wind speed, the design wind speed VZ, given by this formula VB K1 K2 K3 multiplied by K4, where K1 is a probability factor, a risk coefficient, and K2 is the terrain roughness and height factor, and K3 is a topography factor, and K4 is an importance factor for the cyclonic region as per this IS 875 part 3 2015. Whereas Whereas this K4 factor is not there as per the old code 1987, where this risk coefficient is now obtained from this table 1, wherein for 47 basic wind speed for 50 years return period, the coefficient is equal to 1. Therefore, just note down that data. This is equal to 1, just now noted down, right? And also, the second one is the terrain height size factor K2, right? Here the overall height of the column plus rise is equal to 11 plus 4 means 15 meters, and also the length is 48 meters and breadth is equal to 16 meters, and even height is equal to 15 meters. Therefore, now even if I go to old code, actually this K2 is also given in terms of the class of the building. Let me just go to this code 1987 old code, right, where in the new code this class of the building is not there, right? Let me visit to that 1987 code, student, right? A page number, just wait, I need to go to the page number 11. Let me go to this page number 11 of 1987, yes. And then yes, page number 11. There, from that, even as per the old code also, this K1 is equal to 1, whereas this figure we already seen, right? This is how the risk coefficient, just now we already seen that. Second one is terrain height and structural factor, right? It is given by the terrain set, wherein the terrain category 1 means the exposed open terrain with a few or no obstructions, in which the average height of the object surrounding the structure is less than 1.5 meter, right? And category 2 means open terrain with well scattered obstructions having heights generally between 1.5 meter to 10 meters, whereas category 3 means the obstructions are up to 10 meters. Obstructions are up to 10 meters, whereas category 4 means where numerous large, high, closely spaced obstructions are there. If that terrain is there, then that's called the category 4, right? And these are also the same applicable as per the IS 875 part 3 new code also, but whereas as per this old code 1987, student, just I'm highlighting this, right? I do have the class A means the structures whose components such as the sizes, right, of the different maximum dimensions are less than 20 meters, then there is what called the class A, whereas the class B is whose dimensions are in between 20 meters to 50 meters, right? Whereas the class C means whose dimensions are greater than 50 meters, right? Therefore, accordingly, what is this class? Let me just come back, right? Therefore, now I can see that here in the maximum direction, I do have the length the dimensions, as say it is 16 meter, which is less than 20 meters. Therefore, there it is class A. But if I see the length 48 meter, this is just almost right. If it is greater than 50 meters, then that is class C, right? Now, whereas this is class B in the other direction, right? Because it's just less than 50 meters, right? Therefore, that is how the class as per the 1987 version of the wind code, right? And however, the height is 15 meters and surrounded by the small buildings. Therefore, this is a terrain category 3. Just now we have seen what is the terrain category 3, right? Where the heights of the obstructions are up to 10 meters only, right? That is what the terrain category 3 as per the new code as well as the old code, right? Then for this category, now I'll see as per this new code as well as old code, I'll explain both. Let me see as per the old code 1987, right? Where I need to go back to this page 12. Let me go back to this page number 12, student. Yes, not this one. Yes. Right. Let me go to this page number 12. Yes. Right. Therefore, from this now I do have the table K2. K2 is obtained for terrain category 3, for terrain category 3, and for this class of the building, for the class of the building B, for the class of the building B, right? Because I do have a class B building, because this is maximum length is less than 48 meter, therefore this is a class B building. Therefore, for that I am just noting down this K2 for 10 meter and 15 meters. These coefficients as per this 1987 wind code is 0.88 and 0.94. Let me show that, right? This is a 0.88 and 0.94 for 10 and 12 and 15 meters respectively for terrain category 3 and class B. Therefore, once I note down this, I need to interpolate. I need to interpolate for the required required height, right? Therefore, for 11 meter, this K2 is equal to how much? Therefore, upon interpolation, it now works out 0.94 minus 0.94 minus 0.88 divided by 5 multiplied by 4, or say approximately 0.89. Whereas the same coefficients as per the ISS 25 part 3 2015 new code as per the class 6.3.2 page number 5. Let me go to the page number 5 of the new code. New code student, right? Yes. And there in that table 5, table 2, right? Whereas here only terrain categories are there, 1, 2, 3. Therefore, third category wherein I do have the coefficients as 0.91 and 0.97. Therefore, if I interpolate, now I'll get. Therefore, I just interpolated that. Therefore, I do have 0.91 and 0.97. Upon interpolation, I'll get this value as 0.922 for 11 meters. Both as per the old code, as per the new code, I have just given these inputs, right? Therefore, this design basic wind speed VZ as per the old code is just VB, K1, K2, K3 only, right? Whereas this K3, even using both the codes, where K3 is a topography factor, this as per the new code 2015, as per the old code also is the same, right? Whereas if this effect of the topography shall be significant at a site when the upward wind slope theta is more than the 3 degrees. However, if it is less than 3 degree, then it should be taken as 1. However, in the problem, what is already assumed that the area, the site area is a plane. Therefore, in which case, for plane areas, theta is less than 3 degrees. Therefore, K3 is equal to 1. Therefore, as per the old code, if I see this VZ is equal to VB multiplied by K1, K2, K3. Therefore, that is 47 multiplied by 1 multiplied by 0.89 multiplied by 1. R side works out, say, 41.83. As per this 1987 code, whereas as per the new code, 2015 code, it now works out 41 multiplied by 1 multiplied by 0.922 multiplied by 1 multiplied by 4. Cyclonic factor is also 1. Let me go to that cyclonic factor, student, right? As per the new code. This is a K4 is the importance factor for the cyclone. This is not there in the old code, right? It now says that for all other structures it is equal to 1, whereas structures of post cyclonic importance it is equal to 1.3, whereas for such as hospitals, communication towers, etc., right? Or for industrial buildings it is 1.15, right? However, I'm considering an industrial building, therefore it may have taken as 1.15 here, 1.15. therefore now even now I can take 1.15, this factor, right? Instead of this 1, I can take this as 1.15. therefore, if I get this result, therefore now I'll get that result as 45. I'm just modifying that 43.33 multiplied by 1.15. now I'm getting this result as 49.83 meter per second as my design wind speed. Therefore, once I get this, I need to square this value and multiply with 0.6. therefore now I'll get, as per this new code, this PD will now work out a value, say 1489.78. put in 89.78, right? And therefore, whereas as per the old code, it now works out, say, 0.6 multiplied by VZ square, which is 41.89. Therefore, it works out, say, 1049.8 Newton per meter square, or it is approximately 1.05 kilonewton per meter square, right? Whereas as per this new code, this value is now 1489.8. Now let me just change this value, right? 1489.8. Therefore, that is how I'm just having this kilonewton per square meters, right? Square meters. Whereas, as per the new code, if I go to this new code, whereas this P design wind pressure is not as if that of the old code, right? It is not that of, right? Whereas this is as per this class 7.2, PZ is equal to 0.6 VZ square, where PD is equal to PZ. This PZ, what I got, that value is equal to approximately 1490 Newton per meter square, that multiplied by KD, KA, KC, where KD is equal to wind directionality factor, KA is equal to area averaging factor, and KC is equal to combination factor, right? And this PD shall not be taken less than 0.7, whereas this KD for buildings, solid science, open science, etc., for lattice frame buildings, it should be taken as 0.9, or for circular or near circular towers, this should be taken as 1. Now, hence, now what I'll do is I'll do the calculations as per this new code. If I do as per the new code, then I'd have this KD is equal to 0.9, because it is solid building, and KA, area averaging factor. Let me see this area averaging factor as per the new code, should it, right? Because these are not there in the old codes, right? It says that if tributary area is less than 10 meter square, then it should be taken as 1. Therefore, the tributary area is almost, right? Actually, it is 8 multiplied by 2, 16 meters. Actually, tributary area is even less than 25. It is in between, even I can interpolate between 0.9 to 1, but approximately I'm taking as 1, because it is 0.9996 odd value, or say 1, right? Even you can interpolate. Therefore, still I'm saying this as 1. That is a second factor, student. Whereas the third one, what is this KC? What is that KC is the a factor which is called the combination factor, right? Whereas that combination factor should be taken as per this class 7. Revisit this, right? As per this class 7.3.3.13, right? Therefore, as per that, now if I take that value is equal to 0.9, right? Therefore, now this PD is equal to this previous value 1.4898, that multiplied by 0.9 multiplied by 0.9. Therefore, that now works out, that multiplied by 0.81. Therefore, now I am having 1.206 kilonewton per meter square as per the new code also, 1.206, right? Whereas even 1.206, right, as per the old code, it is 1.05. Therefore, now however, here I have analyzed as per the 1987 data. Now, instead of that, now you, instead of 1.05, now you can say as per the new code, you put this value as 1.206, and you can reanalyze and redesign, right? Therefore, I'm just proceeding with that. Therefore, even the height up to the eaves level is 11 meters, and width of the building is B is equal to 16 meters, or this is in that schematic, it is W, notated by W. Therefore, this H by W, this ratio is equal to 11 by 16 meters is equal to 0.6875. Therefore, if I go to this old code, 1987, table 5, page number 16. Let me go to that, table 5, page number 16. Table 5, page number 16. Yes, I'm just moving to that. Yes, because this is applicable for the external pressure coefficients. External pressure coefficients for pitched roofs. The other day I explained this elaborately, right? Therefore, now I do have this, right? I do have what is this H by W, H by W, right? Therefore, that is now working out, right? H by W is equal to 0.6875. Or even as per the new code also, right? New code also, right? The same is applicable, right? Then, this is just greater than 0.5. However, it is less than 1.5. Let me go to this, right? Therefore, I'm just showing as per this code, this is greater than 0.5 and less than 1.5. And I do have this slope is between 20 to 30 degrees, 26 degrees, 59 minutes. Therefore, now I'll note down what are the wind coefficients on EF and GH. Let me show what is that EF. Therefore, this is what EF student had. If wind is blowing, then with 0 degree, then wind is there on the windward side. This is called the leeward side GH, right? Whereas if wind is blowing from in the transverse direction, if theta is equal to 90 degree, then if this theta is equal to 90 degree, then this is what called, right? EG is the windward side, whereas this FH is the leeward side, right? Leeward side. Therefore, these are the notations EFGH, right? Accordingly, what are the coefficients that are given, right? Are just noted down on if wind is blowing from the left side of the building, then these are the coefficients for 20, 30. I'm just noting down this, the coefficients, right? Minus 0.7, minus 0.2, and minus 0.5, minus 0.5. Whereas if wind is blowing from the transverse direction, if the wind is blowing from the transverse direction of this building, right? If wind is blowing from this, theta is equal to 0 degrees, then this is the first column. If wind is blowing from the 90 degree, right? Like this, then that is how all the stresses are subjected to these coefficients, these external pressure coefficients, right? Therefore, I'm just noting down these values as minus 0.8, minus 0.8, and 0.6, minus 0.8 on EG and FH respectively, right? And even the same are the coefficients, even as per the new code also. Let me go to this new code student, right? I'm just showing this, right? Same, there's no change with respect to the new code also, right? Not this one, right? Yes, this one, right? Even I'm showing the IS 875, a new code, right? New code, right? Therefore, I do have the same coefficients are there. Same coefficients are there, right? Same 0.7 minus 0.2, 0.5 for 20 to 30. Where h by w is greater than or equal to half and less than or equal to 1, right? Even if theta is equal to 90 degree, I do have minus 0.8, minus 0.8, minus 0.6, and minus 0.8. There is no change. Therefore, from either of these two codes, if I just interpolate this external pressure coefficient, this table just now given, right? Therefore, now I'll interpolate for theta is equal to 20 degree, right? It is varying from minus 0.7 to 0.2. Therefore, for 26 degree 59 minutes, it is how much? Therefore, upon interpolation, it now works out to minus 0.37, and this 0.5 will remain the 0.5, even 0.8 remains the 0.8 when theta is equal to 90 degree. And if I interpolate between these two, now I'll get for 26 degree 57 minutes on FH, right? On windward side, when theta is equal to leeward side, when theta is equal to 90 degree, it is minus 0.7 upper interpolation. This is how I got the external pressure coefficients, even for both theta is equal to 0 and theta is equal to 90 degrees respectively on different sides, right? Windward side and leeward side and EFGH respectively. And also the internal pressure coefficient, assuming the small or normal openings, or the percentage of the openings is less than 5%, right? 5%. Let me show this Now, photograph student, right? Let me go to this photograph, right? Yes, this is a, if I assume these openings as 5% of this total wall panel area, then there is what called the small openings. Therefore, in such case, as per this coder specification, then internal pressure coefficient is only plus or minus 0.2 only. Therefore, internal pressure coefficient, right? Therefore, now what I'll do? Let me see this internal pressure coefficient also, right? Not this one, right? Internal pressure coefficient as per this new code, right? Where I'm just moving to that internal pressure coefficient. Yes, now you can see that, right? For openings not more than 5%, the internal pressure coefficient is plus or minus 0.2, right? As per the new code, as well as the same is also applicable as per the new code also, right? Now, that is it. Now, once I examine this, now I'll substitute into these calculations. Therefore, now I will have, right? As per this formula, let me go to this new code. What is the formula, right? Yes, this is what the new code student, right? Where in Idaho, the build load on the individual members is given by F is equal to CPE minus CPI multiplied by A multiplied by PDE, where CPE is external pressure coefficient and CPI is internal pressure coefficient, and A is the surface area of the structural elements of the cladding units, and PDE is the design wind pressure. Therefore, now substitute into these so that what are the wind loads on these panel points as well as the end panel points also, right? Like this, right? Therefore, now substituting into this, therefore I am getting this WW is equal to, now when wind is coming from theta is equal to 90 degree, I will have the maximum coefficient as minus 0.8. 0.8 without any interpolation, therefore that will govern the designs for all the roof presses, minus 0.8, minus 0.2. Internal pressure coefficient is minus 0.2, this constant, that multiplied by PD is equal to 1.05, multiplied by this effective area is 2.235 is the panel length, already told, right? 2.235 like this, right? This is the panel length, right? 2.235, right? Or 2.235 by 2. Therefore, for intermediate panel, it is 2.235. Here also 2.235. Whereas for the end panel, it is 2.235 by 2. Right? For that multiplied by 8 meters in the transverse direction or in the lateral direction. Therefore, upon multiplication, it works out say 18.77 or approximately say minus 18.8 kilonewton. That minus indicates that it is the upliftment when wind blows, right, the truss can be uplifted like this. The truss can be uplifted minus, right, suction. Minus means negative or uplift or suction, whereas positive means wind. That wind can act on the roof trusses so that it will give the downward pressure, right? Whereas upliftment means that upward pressure like this, right? Therefore, there is more dangerous. Upliftment is more dangerous, right? Positive is not dangerous. Negative uplift is dangerous. Therefore, now I'll get on the end intermediate panel says 18.8, whereas on the end panel it is half of that, which is 9.4. Therefore, here also I'll get 9.4. Sorry, these are 18.8, 9.4, right? For the panels, when theta is equal to 90 degree on EG, right? Like that, now I need to analyze this three more times, right? Therefore, let us see. Next analysis is on using this. Let me show this, right? Just now analyze this. Let me go back there, right? Just have analyzed these stresses when theta is equal to 90 degree on EG. Similarly, now replacing this 0.8 with a coefficient of 0.73, if I analyze the stresses which are there on this FH, how much it works out? Now I need to calculate. Similarly, when theta is equal to 0 degree, if I analyze on windward side EF, right, as well as on the leeward side GH, what are the values, right? Therefore, now I am doing that, right? When theta is equal to 0 degree, theta is equal to, wind is blowing from the normal direction, right? Not 90 degree direction, right? Normal direction, right? On windward side, just now we have seen that the coefficient is equal to 0.37 student on EF on these side, windward side, right? Therefore, that minus 0.37 minus 0.2, it works out, say, minus 0.57 multiplied by 1.05 multiplied by 8 multiplied by 2.235. I'd say it is working out approximately minus 10.8. Whereas on the leeward side, even if I see, right, on the leeward side, on these side of these truss, right, it is now minus 0.5. Minus 0.5. Please see that difference, right? Therefore, using that 0.5, if I work out, it now works out to minus 0.5, minus 0.2, minus 0.7 multiplied by 1.05 multiplied by 8 multiplied by 2.235. It is working out approximately minus 13.14. Therefore, on the end panels, it is that divided by 2 is 6.57. Therefore, this is how on the windward and leeward side, when wind is blowing in normal direction, right, normal to this length direction, right? Therefore, these are these values. Similarly, when wind is blowing from 90 degree direction, right, the trusses which are there on the other side, right, on the leeward side, like this, right, on FH, right, for which the coefficient is equal to minus 0.73. Therefore, if I see that calculation also, let me see the calculation side. Therefore, for such minus 0.73, minus 0.2, 0.93 multiplied by 1.05 multiplied by 8 multiplied by 2.235. That works out, say, 17.46 uplift, minus indicates uplift, whereas for the end panel is 8.73. Therefore, I have the four results. Therefore, that is how this 18.8, that will govern the designs actually, right? Here also 18.8, whereas here is 9.4 one case side, whereas on the other side when theta is equal to 90 degree, when theta is equal to 90 degree, just now analyzed, I got right 17.46 and 8.73, 17.46 and 8.3, right, 17.46 here and 8.3 here, right? That is how all these are 17.46, here that half of that value, 8 point, that value is equal to half of that, right? Similarly, when wind is blowing, theta is equal to 0 degree, then these are the wind normal to this, which is 10.8, right? On the end panels, this is half of that, 5.4, whereas on the windward side, whereas on the leeward side, these values, same values are minus 13.14 and 6.57. These are minus 13. These are minus 13.14, and on the end it is 6.57 respectively. Right? This is how we have the four permutation and these are the two permutation and combinations. Right? One, wind theta is equal to 0 degree. These are the two different loads on the different panel point joints. Right? Whereas another case is the theta is equal to 90 degree, entirely it is 18.8 and 9.4, or alternatively even it is 17.46 that divided by 2, right? Therefore, these are the three cases I need to analyze, right? This is all the different loads on the panel points, right? I think once I do have these different loads, now I'll start the analysis before I go for the design side. Therefore, now generally, I'll do the analysis wherein, let me start the analysis for the dead load reactions, right? Now, I already have, these are the, let me see this dead load loading student, right? This is what I'm revisiting, right? These are the dead loads which are 7.4, right? 6, 7, 7.4 are there, even 1, 8, 7.4, therefore, right, that divided by 2 means 47.4 is equal to 29.6 is the reaction due to the dead load. This is nothing but these 7.4, right? Here half, therefore 7.4 multiplied by 7.4 multiplied by 4, 7.4 multiplied by 4, right? 29.6 is the dead load reaction, right? Once I get this dead load reaction, similarly, even you can get the live load reaction also. Similarly, you can say 4 multiplied by 6.7, right? 4 multiplied by 6.7, right? And that is the live load reaction is 26.8. That is how even you can get for the wind load also. Wind load also, right? Now, for wind load also. Now let me do this for the dead load. For the dead load, therefore, once I get this 29.6 as the reaction student already explained it. Similarly, for live load, I got 26.8. Now I'll analyze even similarly for wind load also, right? What is the analysis? Is actually it is one when theta is equal to 0 degree, one analysis, right? When theta is equal to 90 degree. On the windward side as well as the leeward side. Therefore, there are three analyses that are required. Now, like this, right? Three analyses that are required. Let me show this, right? Yes, right? Therefore, however, this is actually a combination, right? Even I'm taking 18.8 and 10.8 like that, right? Whereas, if you want to analyze, what you need to do is that you get, what is that vertical load due to this 18.8 and as well as that of the horizontal component, right? Therefore, you resolve these into vertical and horizontal components. And if you want to get the reaction means horizontal load, right? Therefore, you just sum up what are all these, right? However, they are nullified with these on the other side. These all 18.8s are nullified, right? Therefore, with that 18.8, therefore, when theta is equal to 90 degree, I will not get any horizontal reaction. Please make a note because of the symmetry, right? Even similarly, when theta is equal to 90 degree, even on FH, I won't get any horizontal reaction. Only horizontal reaction will be obtained if theta is equal to 0 degree. Please make a note, theta is equal to 0 degree. Therefore, accordingly, you just make note of these 10.10.7 and on the other side, what are these? These values are 13.14. Just now we have seen. Therefore, using that, now you start the analysis. Start the analysis. 13.14 and 6.57, right? Therefore, I do have here 10.8, and here I do have that 13.14. Here instead of 18.8, I do have 13.14 and at the end 6.57. Therefore, obviously here 6.57, here 5. There is a difference. Therefore, that difference of the horizontal forces you obtain, right? Even the difference of these, right? You can obtain, right? That what I am doing in this analysis, right? Therefore, I am finding out that difference, that 9.4 minus this actual, that is how I am resolving them into the horizontal components, right? There are two such components, even there are three more such forces with the differences of these. Actually, I have given 18.8 because of that, it will not be there, right? Only this 13.7 minus 10.8 multiplied by sine 26 degree 58 minutes. There are such three forces. Just wait for a moment, right? There are such three forces, right? Therefore, that is a three, right? These are the three, whereas these are the two, right? Here, one as well as here. The bottom two. Therefore, if I take their horizontal components, right? What is the difference of these two? Because if you are acting to the left or if you are acting to the right, therefore, if I find out what is that summation? That summation is still giving rise to 14.31 using this 18.8. Now you do using this 13.8, that will be a quite different value, student, right? Whereas there at two supports, which are supported on the two columns, right? Therefore, what is that net horizontal force at each of these support is equal to that 14.31 as per the previous calculation. Now we modify this result, that divided by 2. It is working out 7.16 horizontal load, 7.16 horizontal load on this shoe angle, on the base plate support, on this base plate support, like this, 7.16 horizontal force, which is supported onto this column, right? Now once I get this, even I'll get what is the total vertical force also, right? Total vertical force is the obtained as all these 9.4 plus 5.4 vertical components, cast components. There are two such components, and even not this 18.3. Now you replace with 13.7 plus 10.8 cast 26.5 multiplied by, there are three such components, right? Therefore, that now works out, say 105.9, 105.9. Therefore, I have to have all these components. Therefore, now if I take the sum of the moments about this L5 is equal to 0, means the right support is equal to 0, then I will get that support reaction multiplied by 16 meters, right? Now, I already resolved them into components, vertical components and horizontal components. Therefore, if I take sum of the moments about this, therefore, what is this, right? Vertical component 5.4, this cos 26 degree 57 minutes multiplied by 16 meters, right? 16 meters, right? Like that, even you go on taking that of the movements of that of these vertical components as well as that of the horizontal components about this joint student. Therefore, upon doing that, now I'm getting, right? I'm doing like this, right? I'm doing that. Then I'm getting this, right? Like this. Therefore, this 5.4 cos 26 degree 56 minute that multiplied by 16 as well as 88 meter also that is there, right? Similarly, 10.8 cos 26 degree 58 minutes is there at 14 meters as well as 12 meters and 10 meters. And this 9.4 cos 26 degree 8 minutes is there at 8 meters. Similarly, 18.8, actually this 18.8 need to be replaced with 13.64 cos 26 degree 54 minutes, which is there at 6 meter, 4 meter, 12, 2 meter. And this 13.7 minus 10.8, that difference, sine 26 degree 56 minutes is there at 1 meter, 2 meter, 3 meter, right? There is a perpendicular distance. Similarly, this 9.4 minus 5.4 sine 26 degree 58 minutes is there at 4 meters. Therefore, if I do only unknown is equal to what is that support reaction is 47.58 kilonewtons, right? I am just showing this with 18.8 and 10.8. Actually, you need to do this with left 10.8 as well as a right support 13.76. Therefore, this result will modify now, right? Therefore, now I would have total vertical reaction is equal to 105.9. Therefore, what is the reaction at the other end is equal to 105.9 minus 47.5. It works out, say, 58.32 kilonewton. Therefore, I got even the horizontal forces and as well as the reactions due to wind. Therefore, once I get this, now what I'll take is, now I'll start the analysis using the method of joints as well as the method of sections. Now I'll take that of the joint L naught, where I'm showing for dead load. Now I just now I got now I'm showing with that of this dead load, right? Wherein just now I told that I got the reaction, that reaction force as a 29.6. Therefore, I'm just recalling that, right? Therefore, if I just resolve this dead load, let me go back to this schematic student, right? Therefore, let me go back to that. Yes, right? This is due to dead load, right? I have just taken this, right? Wherein I do have this reaction as 29.6 minus 3.7 is the net upward force should be this component, vertical component, should be numerically equal to the component due to this vertical component. Therefore, I'm just equating both of these. That's it, right? Therefore, by equating that, now I'm getting this, right, as that unknown value is equal to that FL0U1 sine. That is sine 26 degree 56 minutes is equal to this difference, 29.6 minus 3.7. Therefore, that load in this component member FL0U1 is equal to, say, 57.92 or say approximately 58 kilonewton compression. Compression means minus 58 kilonewton. Similarly, that of this bottom chord member, that is the top chord member. Similarly, in the bottom chord member, now I do have, by taking the sum of the horizontal forces is equal to 0, FL0L1 is equal to FL0U1 cos 26 degree 58 minute. But by this time I know what is this L0 U1, which is approximately, which is 57.92. That cost 26.56. It works out to 51.81 or approximately 52 kilonewton, which is tension, which is tension. Therefore, tension is notated by plus, whereas the compression notated by minus in our expressions, right? Whereas similarly, I already analyzed for dead load, live load reactions also. Similarly, let me go back to this side. Therefore, I have analyzed using this side for 6.7, right, and then the 3.35. Therefore, doing similarly as I explained for the dead loads, now I'll get the force F L naught U1 sine 26 degree 56 minutes as 26.8 minus 3.35, because that 26.8 minus 3.35, it works out say 52.45, say around 52.5 student, right? Therefore, let us say this is minus 52.5 kilonewton, and similarly, the force in the bottom chord member F L naught L1 is equal to that 52.45 cos 26 degree 56 minutes, say approximately 47 plus miss tension. Similarly, we can do the analysis for the wind. Now let me see this, right? These are the forces due to wind. Just now I explained how I got this 47.58, the support reaction. I'm just recalling that, right? Even if you replace this 18.3 with 13. This odd value, even this 47.58 will change, and we can do on your own, right? That modified analysis, right? Using method of joints and method of sections, right? I am illustrating using this 47.58 plus this 5.4 is also there. This 5.4 cos 26 degree 58 minute, both are acting vertically upward, should be numerically equal to, if I take that vertical component of this F L naught U1, it is with sine 26 degree 56 minute. Therefore, only this is unknown, which now works out say around 117.21. Minus indicates compression, right? Similarly, F L naught L1, that in the bottom chord member, is that 117.21 cos 26 degree 50 6 minutes plus this 7.16, it now works out say approximately 112 kilonewton tension. Therefore, I got these results. Therefore, what now I'll do is I'll just sum up all these results of these forces. Now just I'm summing up, student, right? This due to dead load 58 52, I'm just showing here, just see this side. Therefore, this is the tabular format. This is the member. Just now I got minus 58 compression due to live load. I got 52. And due to wind, I got these forces, tension forces. Just note down in the rafter member. Similarly, you continue the other part of the rafter, right? Just now I analyzed only L naught U1. Similarly, you analyze using method of joints and method of sections U1, U2, right? U2, U3, U3, U4. U4, U5, U5, U6, U6, U7, U7, U8. These are the different forces in such members due to either dead load as well as the live load, or that of the due to wind load. All these forces are written, right? Similarly, on this L0, L1, just now you have seen from the analysis, I got this plus 52 due to dead load as well as plus 47. Due to the live load, as well as due to the wind, I have this 1 total, right? Therefore, 52 plus 47. Also, these two red S, and then L0, L1 plus 52 indicates tension due to dead load, as well as due to the live loads, plus 47. Even other values you can see, right? Due to the wind, right? On the bottom chord member, L0, L1.
Similarly, you continue with the analysis for L1, L2, L3, L4, L4, L5. All these main time members, right? Similarly, you please analyze the entire truss. These are the different forces, not only in the rafter or top compression member, right? And also the bottom chord member. Or that of the main tie, these are the different forces in the bottom part member, and these are the different forces in the top part member, or that of the rafter. right? Basically, it is a compression number, and this is the principal tie or main tie. These are the different forces, and these are the forces in the struts. Right? What are the struts already shown? Similarly, these are the forces in the minor slings, and these are the forces in the major sling, right? This is how the main slings, right? These are the main slings. These are the forces in the main slings, and these are the minor slings, right? These are the different forces in different components of the roof truss, right? Once I get this, I need to go for the design of this structure, right? Now we'll initiate that design. Let me see this design part, right? Therefore, once I get these all the forces after analysis, now I'll go for the designs. Okay, student. I think we'll see those designs in the next class, right? If you have really liked the discussions what we had in today's class, don't forget to click like, share, subscribe, and turn on all the notifications to our YouTube, right? In the next class, we shall see the design of these roof trusses, the design of these members with problems, right? Till then, bye bye, students.